graphic nature of this program, listener discretion is advised.
You go to the baseball game, you go to the football stadium, and they'll say, ladies and gentlemen, 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 we would like, 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 moment, a moment, a moment, a moment, a moment, a moment, a moment. Silence, 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 silence. I don't know what to do. What do you do during a moment of silence? What do they want? What do they expect of me? Do they want me to pray? They don't say that. If they want me to pray, fuck them, let them ask. I'll pray, but goddammit, you gotta ask me. They don't say that. They issue no instructions whatsoever. Sometimes I have evil thoughts.
You're listening to Two Strangers, One Podcast. Now here's Chris and Kristen.
Well, hello and welcome to Two Strangers, One Podcast. I'm Chris.
And I'm Kristen. Hello, welcome back.
And we had, that was our moment of silence for the tragedy in Denver, Colorado. I mean,
Aurora, Colorado.
I have a lot.
You got something to say?
I have a lot to say about all this. And just first and foremost, if you're easily offended, let me just apologize.
You don't mean it, yes.
Yeah, and also, My anger about the whole situation, other than the kid, is media's attention to it and
right.
how they cover it, because
and that's what he wants. Attention.
Yeah.
Getting it.
It's you know, I think I even said in a previous episode, like, and they said this was only like 15 miles away from Columbine,
right.
Columbine High School.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on in Colorado with these guns.
Yeah, it's, you know, I mean, this is a little different because he was 24.
Right.
And I think he was living on his own. He was
in an apartment that was all booby trapped.
Yeah, he was, I think he was like he was going to get his doctorate or something.
And,
like
but
that,
he dropped
you know.
Out. He like, I don't know if he failed out or if he just like left.
Yeah, he had a.
But he was admitted into whatever school.
Yeah, he had a lot of education behind him.
Yeah, smart kid.
And, you know,
and
like...
there was a three-month-old killed. Why is a three-month-old at a midnight viewing?
Yeah, they said one of the victims was like a six-year-old and then a three-month-old.
Three-month-old, yeah.
What kind of fucked up parenting...
I blame the parents on that one.
Are you bringing a three-year-old to...
Three-month-old, yeah.
Now,
the baby's gonna cry.
Yeah.
Baby's not gonna sleep through this whole movie.
What I did last year...
Uh-oh. Tell me you did it now with your daughter.
I brought Raven to go see Transformers 3.
At the midnight viewing?
To the midnight show.
Oh, see?
But you know what? As soon as she started to fuss, I kind of went down, you know, like how now modern movie theaters, the Cineplexes, it's almost like a ramp.
Yeah, it's real high up.
Yeah, so.
Would you go in the water?
I brought Raven down there to calm her down. And yes, it was stupid on my, but
I
as soon
like
as she started fussing.
Yeah. I went to see the Hunger Games, and yeah, I'm one of those.
Uh-huh.
I went to see the Hunger Games, and there was somebody who, okay, the one girl was probably like six or seven. She wasn't, not a big deal, but then they had a baby. Uh-huh. Who was getting fussy and was right behind, like, kicking my chair. That was real annoying. And the six-year-old was talking throughout the whole movie.
Oh, God.
That was so annoying.
It's...
And not talking, like, a little bit, but, like, loud, like, where other people could hear. And they were like, who the hell's talking?
Yeah, it's, you know.
But the three-month-old at a midnight viewing, you couldn't
like
find a babysitter or...
Yeah. See, that was my deal because I wanted to go Thursday night into Friday.
Well, you know what, Chris? You find a babysitter, or you wait till that movie comes out on DVD.
Exactly. Well, no, what
I'm
I did was...
You.
Well, I mean, Transformers is one thing, but you have to understand, Transformers and me, even though the Michael Bay movies were sacrilege...
You had to go?
I had to go.
I blame you. You're one of the people.
Now... No, but as soon as she started fussing, because
right.
there's a lot of explosions and stuff like that,
it's
and the
thing
Michael
with
Bay
Dark
one...
Knight. Wouldn't there be...
Yeah,
wow,
exactly.
Action-packed movie?
I
Why
would have to say...
Why are you bringing this three-month-old?
Because I did go see it Saturday.
Okay.
And the soundtrack, you know, I mean, not to get off topic, but, like, the music was...
They put a lot of money into this. I'm
yeah,
sure it was awesome.
The special... the audio, I do have to say, except for... except for Bane talking, which was... And that's a whole story in and of itself, because they released the first 8 minutes on a website, or
yeah.
they gave it, like, before Spider-Man or something.
Yeah.
And a lot of people were complaining because they couldn't understand Bane, because he has that
right,
filter that, thing over his
so
mouth.
So what does he sound like? Could you understand him throughout
well,
the movie?
Well, no, what they did was...
They changed it?
They... Now you hear him crystal clear.
Okay, so they must
So, it's, you know, it's funny the how Hollywood magic, because obviously they had to go back and do every single
yeah.
line. And with movie magic, now see, if I had never seen those original 8 minutes, it probably wouldn't have bothered me. But now that I saw the original 8 minutes where he's supposed to sound fucked up, I was actually distracted when he was
Chris
talking.
Chris is always pissed about something.
Because how does he have this filter over his mouth, yet you hear him crystal clear?
Chris, they want to give the audience what they want.
Fuck the audience. This is supposed to be reality.
This is for Chris. It's Chris only.
I'd rather have a babbling bad guy. I don't want to
hear. See, that would annoy me that I couldn't understand this guy throughout the whole thing. Like, Arnold Schwarzenegger, never understand him. That drove me nuts.
And
I'm trying to follow the storyline, and I can't even understand the main villain.
And Bane kind of... And I've heard a whole bunch of other people say it, but it sounds like someone doing a bad Sean Connery impersonation.
Okay.
Like, hello, Batman.
That's what it sounds like.
And it's, you know, hello.
Why does he have an accent?
I don't know. And okay.
I don't want people just have an accent just to have it.
Spoilers. I am going to talk about The Dark Knight Rises.
I already heard how it ended.
If you haven't, now, mind you, I listen to regular radio, I listen to podcasts. I'm not the first person on the planet to talk about the movie, so...
So suck it.
If you don't want to hear about it, just...
Mute us for a little bit.
Yeah.
Don't stop listening, just mute us for a little bit.
All right. So he sounds like Sean Connery.
With a bad accent.
And see, from the comics...
I wish I just picked up an accent out of nowhere.
Bane was supposed to be from... They made up this, like, fake Central America...
Okay.
...country. It doesn't exist where he comes from. Which, and in other... Well, the other stupid Joel Schumacher movie, he was just, like, this mindless thug, you know? He always, like, repeated the last word you said, like... Because he was under the hypnosis of Poison Ivy. So she goes, go smash that wall! And he would just go, whoa! You know? But,
smart guy.
Like an animated series, and even in the Arkham Asylum, Arkham City video games, he speaks with a Spanish accent.
He's supposed to have an accent.
He's from Central America.
Okay.
So, you know, what's his name? Ted Hardy?
Ed Hardy?
Tom Hardy.
Ed Hardy's that ridiculous
douchebag t-shirts.
That Gosselin wears. What's his name? John Gosselin?
Yeah. Tom Hardy.
Who, isn't
I
he,
believe,
like,
is British.
Yeah, he has an accent.
But
and you don't expect it. It's funny.
He's supposed to have, Bane is supposed to have a Spanish accent, and that did bother and distract me because he sounded, if he's doing Sean Connery, technically he's almost sounding Scottish.
Right.
You know, hello, Batman. Welcome to my underground lair. I'm going to break your back now.
No, Bane, no!
And then you got Christian Bale. Did you ever see The Dark Knight Part 2?
Yeah, I've seen most of it. Just
because
it was, like, on demand and my brother got it. And I saw it, like, that's the one with Heath.
With Heath Ledger.
Yeah, I saw most of it.
And what a lot of people complain about Part 2 is that Christian Bale spoke real like this.
Yeah, what the hell was that?
I am Gotham's reckoning!
How did his throat not hurt, like, after a scene? Like, that just hurts
Hollywood
me.
Magic. I am not the hero Gotham needs, but the hero they deserve.
He's real throaty and cruff.
Swear to me!
Chris can recite the whole movie.
because The Dark Knight is probably...
He did awesome in that movie.
You know, I'm not a film snob, I'm not a, you know...
Or are you?
I'm just saying, no, I know, I have my opinions.
Yeah.
The Dark Knight is one of the, I would probably say, one of the best movies of our generation. You know what I'm saying? Like, Heath Ledger, who I was not a fan of, you know what I'm saying? I never saw 10 Things I Hate About You.
He didn't do, like, movies that you would want to see.
You know, yeah.
But that was kind of like his breakout for other guys to get into.
In a guy's world, he's a pretty boy. I don't want to fucking deal with him. Even though he was in The Patriot with Mel Gibson.
Right.
You
know, this was like
I want to hate this pretty motherfucker. And then, you know, and I've said it before, I am kind of mad when you have the whole world at your feet. You know, you got money, you got girls throwing themselves at you. You know, you got fame. Obviously, he's got talent, because the Joker character, he owned that character.
It was creepy.
And those are...
Creepy to watch him.
You know, because...
He played it perfect.
Before that, they had Jack Nicholson as the Joker. So those are big shoes to fill. Those, you know, to do his own thing were...
Where he had his own twist on it.
There are a lot of people who say that they like his Joker more than Jack Nicholson's. So,
Well, Jack Nicholson's was just like Jack Nicholson.
Yeah,
like,
it was, he's Jack Nicholson
that
in makeup.
The perfect person to play. Yeah, it was him.
And you know, his accent in the movie, he has a Chicago accent.
Okay.
Joker sounds like someone from Chicago.
From Chicago.
And what they, and with the, because the movie, they use a lot of the monuments for Chicago to represent Gotham City. But now in The Dark Knight Rises, there's
Central
a lot
America.
Of New York. No, it's New York.
I know for being
even to the point
America.
Where when they show a shot of quote-unquote Gotham City, you see them with the half-built Freedom Tower.
Oh!
You know what I'm saying? Like
up and running.
What's still coming up right now, the Freedom Tower. There's a half-built Freedom Tower
like
in Gotham City.
A year
City.
Ago, they took that shot.
Yeah, it's like,
you know,
for the movie that had so much special effects, they should have either completed it
right.
or taken
cool.
it out.
Yeah.
It was, you know, and, all right, so once again, or now we're about to get into spoilers. You know, Bane decides to do, you know, he's going to set Gotham free by creating chaos.
Well, of course. Isn't that what they all do?
Yeah, like, yeah, exactly.
They're
like,
never going to set it free by being nice and, you know, giving people candy and stuff. Let's just create chaos.
So, and you do see one part in the commercial, so it's not really spoiling it, but, like, they blow up every bridge
oh, yeah.
that comes
you see
in and out of,
just
quote-unquote, Gotham City, but it's New York,
New York.
City. And,
well, it was always that under the impression that Gotham City was New York. Like,
a lot of people
it was their
say
interpretation
that,
of New York, I guess.
But some people say that, like, when you read the comics, New York City and Gotham City are two different places.
Okay.
You can visit both. And you could also visit Metropolis, is where Superman's from. But Metropolis was in New York City,
yeah.
you know what I'm saying?
I just always had that impression that it was New York. Just, I guess, because most of the movies kind of were based there.
Yeah, it's...
Or had that look to it.
Yeah, it's. I mean, I guess just for production value, instead of, like, doing, like, what they did with Tim Burton and building a city
building
from scratch.
Building a whole city for yourself.
Just use... And, you know, like, you know, there's a part where Bane goes to the stock exchange. You know, and of course they call...
Exactly.
They don't call it Wall Street, but they say, you know, down on Banker Street,
yeah.
you know. And... You know, but it's the Wall Street
Wall
Exchange.
Street.
You know,
on Baker Street.
And in the movie, they even say, "Oh, he's taking the South Street Tunnel," which in New York is the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel. But it's
so
funny that the street that goes
over,
there is
yeah.
South Street. So
they're changing the names, but it's also
yeah, the
similar.
South Street Tunnel, which is the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel for anyone else who lives and knows New York City. And so
he's going to the Liberty Towers.
He's going to the. The Statue of Justice.
Of freedom, yeah.
The Statue of Freedom. Hello, and we're back. I don't know, it's the jinx of...
Of us? I don't know.
It's the jinx of the episode. Because last week, we recorded a show, and in between episodes, I jinxed it and said...
You know, that went really well.
That went really well. I'm surprised we didn't have any problems.
And
then...
we're going to record the second episode.
And
dun, dun, dun.
I was literally on the laptop for like 2 hours. So now it's two strangers, one microphone. I should have listened to my audio engineer buddy Andy, and
he
said, "Just use one mic, dummy."
We always try to, you know.
And I don't know. I paused it, and now it doesn't want to work. So
typical day in the life.
Yeah, I can never get anything to go my way.
So what are your thoughts on?
Shooter. Oh, I lost.
Well, first of all, have you seen him with his hair? Orange?
With his red hair.
And they don't know, well, I mean, it's still under investigation. It might be King's psychosis, or, I mean, he looks crazy.
Well,
but.
He's, like, when you watch, like, there's that show, Big Bang Theory. And you got
never
the show.
Heard you talk about it.
Well, never
heard you talk about it.
It's one of my favorite shows. when you got a character like Sheldon Cooper,
right.
And Sheldon's character, he's such a genius, but part of him being a genius is he's been separated from society, you know, he has no compassion,
he's
he has no,
good.
Yeah, so, you know, and of course, you know, that show makes a joke out of
right.
being socially awkward and, but there are people like that where
oh, yeah.
they're so smart, but with
but
that,
socially,
yeah, with that,
gone.
They're not connected to reality. And,
I mean, he does, when they showed him in the courtroom, he looked, I mean, he generally kind of looked crazy. I mean, just looked out of it. And,
yeah,
know.
He looked a little nutty. And unfortunately,
these
time bombs are out there. There are people out there who, just because he's smart, you know,
doesn't a threat.
Take away the fact that, you know, people can fucking snap at any second.
They just caught another guy, just the other day, like in Massachusetts, like he went to the theater.
Uh-huh.
At a book bag, whatever. He went, saw the movie. movie. Uh-huh. Driving home, I don't know why they pulled him over, I don't remember.
Uh-huh.
But they found all in his book bag, so all these handguns, so he had the, they found out that he did go to the theater with it, but he wasn't planning to do anything at the theater. They found all these news clippings of the Aurora shooting in his car, and then I think either they hoaxed it out of him or whatever, but he admitted that he was not gonna do anything at theater, but he was gonna, do something to his previous life. I don't know if he was afterwards. It's all just a bunch of,
like we said before, like the Columbine shooting. And not that, you know, I'm saying it should have happened, but I get it. You know what I'm saying? Being a kid that was in school and you know, being the victim of bullies and stuff like that. You know, I get it.
Snap.
Even going back to your old employer, shooting him up. I get it.
I want to go back to some old employer.
Yeah, I don't understand shooting up a movie theater. Like, that's the one thing, you know, I would like to, because I've dealt with fucking psychopaths, you know, working in a prison, I've dealt with genuinely crazy people. And
you have no connection with these people, they're just there, and that's really you need to target.
Yeah, the only thing, the only thing I'm getting out of it, and of course, you know, my dime store psychology, is that he just wanted to feel power.
Yeah.
He wanted to feel, I mean, you know, once again, you could be the biggest genius in the world, you know, there's probably some girl he wanted to impress, or...
He has, like, they found, like, different profiles, like, for Match.com.
Yeah, he was...
FriendFinders, like, different ones where he even put, like, would you...
Visit me in prison. Yeah,
what
he knew
hell?
That's
and
definitely
then he was rejected
showing...
by like 3 people. So maybe that sent him over the
well, I mean, that definitely shows premeditation.
Oh yeah,
they've
been planning it for so long. Yeah,
but,
it wasn't just a whim.
Yeah, I don't. The one thing, like I said, other than exerting some sort of power, you know, it's kind of like the reverse of like while powerful guys go to see like an S&M woman. Like usually,
right.
When you have a lot of power in life, you go and see someone so you can feel helpless. So this is the opposite. He probably feels so helpless in life that he mail ordered, you know, military gear, gas masks, guns, and you know, he had 2 Glocks, a shotgun, and an AR-15. Well, no. That's everyone keeps saying no. He had it. Well, in what I understand, he had an AR-15. Which is a modified.
Okay.
Now,
he had so much ammunition there. Just...
Yeah, he had like 100 magazine clip.
Right.
Now, I shot an AR-15. And, of course, the deal with that weapon is that, one, it's inexpensive. Relatively inexpensive.
Affordable.
They said he got all those guns for less than $1,000. I think that's bullshit. But I'm pretty sure he could have gotten all those guns in less than $3,000. You know what I'm saying? Now, and they're like, oh, how does he's a doctorate kid who's 24. I'm pretty sure he could scrounge up $3,000. I mean, you know, if he could scrounge up $3,000 for a used car,
yeah.
A psycho can scrounge up $3,000.
If you want to get it, you can get it.
Yeah, for a gas mask. And, you know, there's plenty of, like, military.
All, like,
he had,
a bulletproof vest. Yeah,
he had.
He was all geared up.
Now, see, and I went crazy on Twitter and Facebook, and you know, I was making a lot of fucking rude comments. But as more of the story unfolded, they said that he opened the door to the he had the gear in his trunk.
Okay.
I think he might have been wearing the stuff that he was wearing. So he left the theater to grab his stuff, came back in, had like a canister of gas, and
people
now
thought that was like. Somebody just...
Yeah, they thought it was some sort of promotion
like
for the movie.
Yeah. It was only like 10, 15 minutes into the movie.
Now, you know, obviously what they said, like 60 people were shot or 12 people were killed. And
I think 12 killed. I don't know.
But you're going to see, I mean, I guess no one wants to get involved, but you see someone leaving the theater and coming back. I mean, I'm pretty sure somebody...
Right. I don't know, because
I hate it. When I'm in a movie theater and people get up and move, it gets my attention.
I see that. Yeah, exactly. I look, because it's not like you just get up and walk out. You're making noise. It's quiet. You have to go by people.
Yeah, it's...
You always see those people
obviously,
walk out.
You know what? I think they said 60 or 50 people were shot and 12 were killed. So
yeah,
you're talking about there was at least 62 people in that theater.
Right.
And, you know, leaving the theater, coming back, and maybe it's because it's a Colorado thing, but like, you know, where's the theater security? Why isn't...
Where was, like, nobody saw him walk in with all this shit.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's one of him leaving and then coming back,
right.
You know, and once again, maybe it's because it's that area. If I see someone coming back and they got a fucking military helmet on and a gas mask,
nobody saw this guy
my instinct is, let's get the fuck out of here.
Right.
you know, and then unfortunately, I'm pretty sure everyone bottlenecked into the door, like trying to leave, like everyone's trying to leave through the door.
And, exit and stuff. And this one girl, I guess, she was so close to, you know, she huddled, whatever, she didn't get exit.
Uh-huh.
She thought it was, her face was burning while she was like huddled down, and she thought it was from the gas.
Uh-huh.
Well, apparently, he was so close to her, she didn't get hit, but he was so close to her that it was the gunpowder.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, it's
scary.
You know,
because it wasn't like he was aiming at certain people.
Yeah,
he was just shooting.
Yeah. And I just, because once again, the AR-15 for an inexpensive gun, for a relatively inexpensive gun, it can shoot pretty well. I've shot an AR-15 at like 75 feet or whatever, 25 yards or whatever you want to call it, you know, and still got a bullseye. And, you know, not that I'm like this super gun, person. I'm pretty sure I had a lot more practice, but I mean, you know, the Glocks, you know, I've shot a Glock because my brother has, you know, I've gone to the shooting range with my brother and he had his Glock. Glocks are very smooth. That's the, you know, that's why like NYPD cops have them.
Yeah.
You can bust out 16 shots as soon as easy as pulling the trigger. You know.
I was watching this one video. It's really sad, but somebody had like a cell phone video of, you know, people coming out.
Uh-huh.
So you're watching this video and this one guy, you know, holding his arm, he got shot in the arm. So you're like, oh. But then right behind him, I hate to laugh, but it's so awful. There's a guy dressed up in just full on Batman costume.
Shit.
You know, coming right behind, like so serious. Like trying to help in this Batman costume. Like
yeah, it's
full on decked out.
Well, that's like,
oh my god, look at these people.
That's my problem with the media is that like,
keep blowing in the wind.
You know, they got, all these cameras out front and, and I don't know, maybe it's like, if I was there and someone I cared for got shot or whatever, I would never go back to that theater again. You wouldn't see me in the parking lot. There's all these pictures now, people calling and prayer circles and all this other stuff. And like, they're in the parking lot. Like the person makes sure, you know.
Like post-traumatic stress.
Yeah, these, you know, these fucking vultures come, the photographers.
Yeah.
These fucking vultures come, and first they have like a picture of the theater by itself. Then they have a picture of the theater kind of pulled back by like two police cars and a police tape. Then, but like, who are these people coming back to the theater? Now, you know, maybe that's part of the healing process, but then you got these fucking vultures taking pictures of it.
Just, like, it's like you can't even mourn because it's like, I'm distracted, there's all this shit going on.
And you have people mourning where obviously the
like,
cameraman had to be 2 feet from their face.
Right, they're not 200 yards away. They're right there, you know. And they're asking questions, you know, like, oh, it's like, I just need the apple.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, I'm really, really disgusted with the media and how they handled the situation. You know.
Even with like, so random to bring up, but Sylvester Stallone's son.
Yeah.
Like, let the guy mourn. I feel like they're just right there. Like, you have all these pictures of him, you know, even at the funeral. Even with the F alone, right? He just lost his son. Nobody knows what happened. Like, just, I mean, what's the point? You want a shot of him crying?
Yeah,
it's very
you know, like, you know, I joke and I say I want to be famous and stuff like that, but you know, I don't know if I could deal with cameras in my face like that. Like,
I'm on the celebrity side when they knock out a paparazzi, because I would too. I find that so disrespectful.
Yeah, I just like when you see it's all the pictures in the parking lot that bother me. You know, saying first, you know,
these
people that have to get a picture of, you know, because it. I think it's like a newer multiplex, but it has like that big neon sign up front.
Says,
like it's kind of like the old school Cinema 16 or some shit like that.
Yeah, something like that.
And you know, why do you need a picture of that? You know, saying and then these people standing in the parking lot, and maybe
like,
it's there.
It's like, leave them alone.
Yeah, I wouldn't.
Honestly,
you know, if I cared about. You know, have your prayer circle at home. Have your prayer vigil, you know, at your church or whatever. You know, if that's what brings you comfort, why would you go to
see, I'm not going
where
back
this tragedy back. Happened? You know what I'm saying? Like,
I don't need to be in that area.
Yeah, it's like.
I think I would just have post-traumatic. Like, I probably wouldn't be able to go to the movie.
Yeah, and like, time. You know, like 9/11, you know what I'm saying? I'm not going to go to Ground Zero. I mean, I know it meant a lot for the families to go down there and stuff like that, but it just, if it was me, luckily I didn't know anybody in the World Trade Center, but I don't.
For me personally, I didn't know anybody, but I don't know if I would want to go to that spot.
Yeah,
it was powerful enough for me going there and not knowing anybody.
Uh-huh.
Like, this just has like that silence, and I mean,
I don't want to.
It's very eerie because you know what happens right where you're standing.
Yeah.
But if I knew somebody, I feel like I'd just be on the ground crying.
Yeah,
like,
I don't want
to control myself.
So it's just. I don't know, and it's just, so like we were saying,
so I guess he said he was the Joker.
Yeah, he said he was the Joker.
He surrenders too. He's like, yeah, it was me.
He wanted to get caught. He wanted some sort of attention. Maybe from The Dark Knight Rises, maybe he thought, you know, it's that cool idea of like, you know, I'm gonna bring anarchy and I'm gonna, and it's,
all about Gotham City.
Which is, odd coincidence. Was that?
I blame the comics.
The comics?
It's all anarchy. Maybe if we have peace. He would just bring peace among everyone.
It's, you know, he wants to be a rock star. He wants, you know, he wants the media attention, and it's like,
it's like violence on TV. Now there's violence in the comic book that are creating this. Okay,
it's look.
We gotta take him off the show.
He needed to get laid. He need. It's. I blame whoever his last girlfriend was.
Right. Yeah. What did she do to him?
Had she?
Or the people who.
She left him because he's a creepy fuck. He'd probably shoot. I'm not gonna give him. It looks like the kind of guy that would shoot up a fucking theater.
Right. I like one of his things. They had like what they said in his profile, like real quick.
Uh-huh.
Like one of his favorite movies, Dumb and Dumber. I'm like, this is so random.
Yeah. They said he was addicted to the video game Guitar Hero. That's one of the, I heard that in a couple sources.
What the hell?
So it's like, you know, first and foremost, just how did not anybody see him
leaving out? I really don't get that.
Cause I thought, this is what I thought at first, that it being opening night, like you said, there was a guy there dressed up like Batman.
Like maybe you could, like,
if he came in, what character is he being? Yeah.
If people dress up as Batman.
Like a riot cop or something. Yeah, like
what is he being? That you'd be like, oh, he's that character.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck is he wearing? I don't want to be near that guy.
Now, I could only imagine, now, wearing a riot helmet and a gas mask, like,
and then in
Colorado, because, you know, I have friends in Colorado on my Facebook and stuff like that.
Oh, Colorado, first the wildfires, and now this.
And there is a big, gothic scene in Colorado.
Really?
Yeah.
You know what the problem is? They have legalized marijuana. That's the problem.
It's, they got all these,
it's
these people who, you know, it's these people who don't raise their fucking kids. It's like, you know,
the parents see this coming, because
the mother, as soon as they called the mother and they told the circumstance and she said, yep, you got the right guy.
She knew
she was raising a fucking psycho.
Now she's saying that was taken out of context. I'm using air quotes here, as I say.
Yeah.
But she's saying, no, they said his name, and she said, yes, that's us.
Yeah, because there's a million, is it James Hume?
Holmes.
James Holmes. Yeah. That's the most, you can't get any, you might as well, you know, Mike Smith.
Yeah.
That's such a freaking, you know, common name.
I'm sorry, if I ever did that, my parents would disown me, not want to talk to me. They'd be like, I'm not standing by you, see ya. You started this mess, you get out of it.
And there was a lot of people on Facebook who coincidentally had the same name.
Oh, no.
And there's people sending him, like, threats and like, obviously, if you have any idea of the story, the guy was arrested. You know what I'm saying? Like, people are sending, like, nasty Facebook comments.
He's not
checking his status.
Like, oh, man, I have checked Facebook.
He's sitting in fucking...
on my adult profile.
He's sitting in the county jail.
Can't see if I got a girlfriend on Match yet. Like, he's not checking that, people. He's,
you know,
he's bars right now.
These poor individuals haven't have the same name.
Jimmy Holmes out there of the world.
Yeah, you're going to get harassed. Hey, asshole. He's in jail. He's not checking his, you know, status.
Some people don't have that concept. And they need to just let him run around after he did all that. He's got to check his online status.
So, I mean, of course, you know, amongst the other people I should feel bad for. I feel bad for anybody named
James Holmes
in Colorado, which there was a lot of.
What's going on over there?
It's a common fucking name, and it's like, these people are so... crazy. Why would you even send a Facebook message? Even if it was the killer. What if they did find his page? What is sending his message?
I'd be scared he tracked me down if he's out and running. I don't need that problem in my life.
You denied my friend request.
He's shooting
Farmville. That's why he's shooting all these fucking Farmville requests. That'll make me shoot up a fucking theater.
Play the word, Jimmy. Play the word.
Right. What's that one? Gangster Land or whatever. Like,
I don't know.
But it's one, like, gangster something that's like Farmville.
You brought the fucking gangster out of somebody.
Yeah. I blame Facebook.
And, you know, and this is gonna sound really insensitive, but like, for the survivors or whatever, like, they go, you know, oh, they're traumatized. But like, you were gonna go see Batman The Dark Knight Rises. You know, here's a movie about New York City getting blown the fuck up.
Well, then there really is.
And then you're seeing real shit, you know, today's society.
I would be traumatized.
Yeah, I don't know, it's like.
I heard shit going up and I'm there. Yeah. And there was another one who had a baby there, but they survived. It wasn't even a year old. Ugh. I don't remember, but she was like, yeah, we were going to sit in the front, but then we decided we'll sit in the back, and that's how she survived. Mm-hmm. The last minute they changed. Uh-huh. Why is there a baby in the... Now there's two babies in the theater.
Two babies at, like, what was it, like a midnight show?
A midnight showing. Right, so the people bringing your kid, Chris Cologne, to the theater...
Well, yeah, I know. Well,
like
five. I left
like
my baby. So I
it.
Went, so, me and Jackie went to go see it on Saturday. Yeah. I left my daughter with her grandfather.
Okay, there you go, you're improving.
And we went to the 350 show.
Okay.
And
was it cheaper?
Actually, it was. You know, I'm so used to, it was
it,
actually
was like,
matinee prices.
Yeah.
And he
was like,
oh,
I forgot they even do that.
Only $16 for two tickets? That's awesome. Which is sad.
A bottle of water?
We spent $24 on
it. Oh, sure. It's literally $5 for water.
Yeah, we got two large sodas. And then, mind you, this is like the combo.
Right,
two
yeah,
sodas.
The combo.
And you know what it is? I just.
$0.50 extra, you can.
I just wanted, you know, it was a movie going experience.
Yeah.
This is probably the only movie I'm gonna go to the theater and see.
This one didn't fall off the truck.
Yeah. Well, I heard such great reviews, and I don't know who the fuck are these people reviewing it, because there was one review where a guy goes, you know, Avengers was, oh, Jesus. You know, someone's like, oh, okay, let's just say the Avengers is a 9.5, this is an 8, you know what I'm saying? Like,
and you thought this was much better.
It was boring. It was.
Avengers or this?
No, The Dark Knight Rises.
Boring?
It was, now don't get me wrong, it was epic.
Epic.
It was, you know,
yeah,
big,
sure,
huge.
The other one before, part two, was better than this one, but this one was still good.
Yeah, it's like, you know, now, if I, maybe because I thought it, I'll probably like it more when I watch it more, like, to now that it, seeing that it wasn't what I expected it to be. But, like...
Did you have a conclusion? Because I've heard, like, it's... I've heard what the ending is, but I don't know the whole storyline.
Yeah.
So it really didn't
well,
mean much to me.
Well, spoilers.
Did
spoilers.
You feel like that was a decent ending?
I hated the ending. And,
good and bad, yeah.
Well, because...
Is that kind of like you interpret it sort of thing?
No, because he...
I love the ending.
Well...
I love the whole movie.
Because remember, they thought Batman died, but then Alfred saw him at the, because there's a bomb that's going to go off. And
spoiler.
I said spoiler about a minute ago. There's this nuclear device that's
an atom bomb.
And it's supposed to be the core of this device that's supposed to spread energy.
Okay.
And, but they took the core out of it, so the core becomes the bomb. And since it's not in its container, after 27 days of not being in its container, it's gonna blow up, no matter what. Whoa. So, you
it's
know.
Like that 20, what is it?
28 days 28
later. 28 days later.
And so at the end of the movie, you know, Batman has his little, I call it the Batwing. In the movie they called it the Bat. It's his flying, the Bat. He takes the Batwing with the bomb and flies off into the distance and blows up all into the, over the water. And, but through the whole movie they kept pushing this issue that like the Batwing didn't have autopilot.
Okay.
And,
so, like,
but then they do, then it's like one of the last scenes, Lucius Fox.
They can't create anything. You know, they always have the best sophisticated technology, and he can't get autopilot on his wings.
And
that's bullshit.
That's, you know, it was, you know, it's one of those convenient movie devices, so we're like, you know, they have
to. Well,
we
don't have autopilot.
Oh, I don't have autopilot, so I guess I have to fly it off to the distance to kill myself. You know, saving Gotham in the process.
You know, just saving the world again.
But then you
here
find out that he does.
See, I thought he died.
Well, that's where I get a little convoluted, because Batman allegedly dies.
Okay.
So remember, there's Batman and Bruce Wayne.
Right.
Then there's a scene where Alfred is crying, because now they have Bruce Wayne's grave right next to his parents' grave.
Okay.
And so Alfred is like crying because, like,
he's a wuss.
Well, because he feels bad. He's like, you know,
first you guys die, you left your son with me, and I couldn't even help him enough, so he's dead.
Alfred.
So, but then, Alfred is like in Europe, and he sees, well,
gallivanting across Europe.
I don't know, he doesn't have anyone to work for anymore. And I honestly, in my heart of hearts, feel...
Is this like the last scene he's in Europe?
He's in Europe, okay. And he's at a cafe, and he sees Bruce Wayne at the cafe with Catwoman, with Selina Kyle. Now, I do have to say, Anne Hathaway, on fucking point.
Oh, because somebody's
on point.
I feel like she cannot do wrong in any movie she does. I love her as an actress.
Well, I mean...
Even in Princess Diaries, she did great.
They wrote her well.
Good.
They wrote, you know, I have absolutely...
Did you like her in the one before? Was she in all three?
No, 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 no. She was just in this one.
Who was in the one before?
No, you have...
Oh, it was just,
Katie Holmes.
Yeah.
Then you had Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Okay,
who
yeah.
technically were playing the same character.
Okay.
I guess they just couldn't get Katie Holmes and to be in part two, so they got...
She's going through her time right
saggy
now.
Saggy Maggie Gyllenhaal. Saggy. Looks like Droopy Dog. You know, and I think I mentioned this before. I think there's a movie called Secretary.
Oh, is this where?
If you like Fifty Shades of Grey,
oh, is this where it's raunchy and she?
It's very raunchy, and she's a submissive secretary, and it's in that movie. Oof, you know what I'm saying? That was before she started.
Sagging.
No, I think she's the only star in it. Maybe
I might have made that
one
up.
Of the Wilson brothers.
Of course,
maybe not Owen. Owen Wilson's the one with the crooked nose. Who's the other one? Luke Wilson. It might be Luke Wilson. I don't know.
Secretary.
A movie called Secretary, but it's all about sadism, masochism, and it's a very, very hot movie. And she looked good in that one, but in Dark Knight, and that's what kills me is in, you know, $1 million cameras, $1 million effects. Yeah, exactly. You know, Christian Bale could jump off a 100-story building, but they can't tighten up that sagginess. You know, I'm supposed to believe that Christian Bale could jump from the top of a building and glide into a moving plane that's passing by, but you can't fix up saggy Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Saggy Maggie. Poor girl.
And
poor girl. Her brother's hot, and she. And...
And,
Sorry, Maggie.
And apparently she's not wearing a bra in the movie either. So really saggy, Maggie.
That's sag, Mag.
Well, she was in, what was that other one with, Will Ferrell? Stranger Than Fiction.
Oh, I didn't like that.
What? I love that movie.
It was really boring to me.
Maybe because I'm a writer.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's like.
You like that boring stuff.
Yeah. I love that movie.
No, I was real bored throughout it. I
wow.
I don't think I finished it.
Wow.
I was like, this isn't Will Ferrell.
Oh, yeah, no. Well, it's not a, but that's one of the credits I get to the movie is
going
that.
He real great, and then he went right to do this movie, and then turned back on the right street.
Well, I'm sick and tired. Like, after, like, Semi-Pro, and, you know, I'd never saw it, but like, you know, I mean, but he did drama. He did like, Everything Must Go, which is supposed to be a dramedy.
I didn't see that, but it kind of looked
like
a dark comedy.
But I actually liked Stranger Than Fiction because he wasn't being that outrageous character.
Yeah.
I mean, he flips out a couple times in the movie, but he's not being that like, stupid for stupid's sake.
Yeah.
You know.
You know what movie, did you see previews for the campaign?
Yeah.
You know where I saw previews for the campaign was Magic Mike.
Magic Mike, yeah.
And it looks hysterical. I'm sorry. That looks like a funny movie. With Zach Galifianakis.
And, you know, because Will Ferrell, Will Ferrell was on Broadway playing George W. Bush.
Yeah.
So I think he's kind of like,
awesome.
Without straight up being George W. Bush, kind of playing a character like that who's a fucking idiot. So.
And I love what's his name, Zach Galifianakis. Say you love him. Say you love him. Say you look like.
Zach Galifianakis is part of that new wave of comedy, which I don't understand.
I find him so funny.
Even last night, there was a commercial for Aziz Ansari.
Because
apparently he's trying to follow Louis C.K. He has a comedy special that you can get on his website for $5. Because Louis C.K. did that and made like millions of dollars.
Aziz
Ansari is not funny.
You know where he's funny is when he plays a character. Like, I like Parks and Recreation, and he's funny in that.
Uh-huh.
But his stand-up is mostly, like, him name-dropping.
Yeah, and then he hangs out with Kanye West, so that's even more of a reason
like,
for me to hang out.
Funny.
Those two belong with each other, I'll tell you that.
Him, Kim Kardashian.
Oh my god. Oh my god. If those three were in a car chased by the paparazzi and somehow got wrecked in an underground tunnel, oh, I'd be so happy.
You know, he always like name drops throughout the whole thing, but I've never seen like pictures of them together. Yeah. You know, like paparazzi photos, like that. Because he seems,
and then like
he's like they're probably like at a club and he hears about it and he goes, like I can see him being one of those.
Yeah, he'll go just because the celebrities are there.
Just so you know, because he might have grown up with Saggy Maggie. You know where she's from?
Where?
The Lower East Side.
Holy shit.
We're neighbors.
Oh, wow. How old is she? She's
77.
Oh, shit. She's my age.
You guys might have hooked up.
So I probably grew up. Wow.
She doesn't have a different name. It's Margaret Ruth Gyllenhaal, so.
And her brother's... Wow, she grew up in the Lower East Side?
Jake Gyllenhaal.
No, but I'm just saying is that, like, I don't know where they probably lived on...
They probably
in
alphabet. Like,
see, because Lower East Side is actually broken up into different sections.
Okay.
I guarantee you they probably lived in Alphabet City.
Is that not a good area? Or is it?
In the late in 70s, early 80s, it was a fucked up area. Okay. And now it's gotten so gentrified, and I've said this before.
Because I know I'd been there before, and it was like, I didn't belong.
Because all these people who watched episodes of Friends and episodes of Sex and the City flooded the fucking city. It's all fucking hipsters. Well, at least downtown is.
Oh, yeah.
Now, where I used to work, which is within walking distance from my house, I used to work on Delancey Street, on Essex Street, right off Delancey.
That's like right by Wall Street.
Wall Street is more on the west side. This is the east side. It actually is so east, a couple blocks down, you're crossing the Williamsburg Bridge into Brooklyn.
Oh, okay.
And then, plus, you got Williamsburg, which is fucking hippie central.
That is terrible.
You know, they should drop a fucking...
Nice, I like that.
Batman should have taken the wing and dropped the bomb in Williamsburg, Brooklyn.
You know, I like the area.
Uh-huh.
Like, I thought it was, like, a cute place. But the people, I'm like, ugh.
And
they gross me out. It's all just... It's
so... Because... Now, mind you, where I work, the Lower East Side, the Essex Street Market, which is still there, well, the building is still there. All those buildings around there are tenements that have gotten fixed up.
Okay.
And actually, there are two disgusting, there's a hotel and this other building, which are like 20 stories high, sticking out in the middle of tenements.
Like, it doesn't look right.
Now, I used to work in a check cashing place there. And so, being that, I used to deal with a lot of landlords in the area. Because, you know, they used to do large cash transactions.
Yeah.
And what I loved in the 90s were these landlords did not give a fuck. Because these, forgive me for all these white people who want to live their little Friends and Sex in the City fantasy.
They would go
and pay $1,200, $1,500 for this piece of shit. It was basically a tenement apartment filled with rats, filled with roaches.
So
you know what I'm saying? Like, basically, it was, before they were there, there was probably some old Jewish woman that lived there till she was 90.
Yeah.
Dropped dead. She was in, when she had, it was rent control. She was paying, you know, $250 a month. And as soon as they left, now mind you, the landlords, and there was one particular landlord I was really cool with, and he basically told me he didn't give a fuck. You know, you slap a new coat of paint on.
Yep, that's all they do.
And charge four or five times as much as what they were.
So it's such a good problem.
And then, you know, they were waiting for the old people to die.
Right.
You know.
They can do it. Now, where I live, which was Upper East Side, we had, like, it was a nice neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
I mean, our building wasn't the best, but it was in a good area.
Mm-hmm.
We live, like, we're on the fourth floor.
Uh-huh.
Apartment 13, how lucky. And then, it was two bedroom, but they easily, like, the other bedroom that I had was real small. It basically fit my dresser, my bed, that's it. Like, there was a closet, but, like, that's it. You're not walking around.
Uh-huh.
And there was easily, like, a closet or something that they just kind of opened up. Like, they easily expanded it into the living room. Like, you could see where it's, like, cutting off this window that's there. Like, it's halfway through. It's awkward.
Yeah.
But it was enough space for the two of us, but I wouldn't say huge. And that, with everything, like bills and all that stuff, each of us paid it out. And that, I thought, was
$2,000 a month.
Right, for both.
I mean, Upper East Side.
Yeah. Our luck, it was a good location, and that was it. So now, after a year was up, they're like, oh yeah, we're raising the rent $500. What? No, we're out.
They want to see how much they can get. Because
and all they did was slap on a coat of paint. Like, we didn't even have fans in our room. Like, my dad put fans on.
Uh-huh.
And it's so fucking hot. Like, I mean, we were lucky it was a good area. Like, it had everything around us. Like, pizza. And then, like, you know, like, Whole Foods and all that.
Uh-huh.
But, I mean, now you're just going to raise the rent for no reason.
Because even though you won't pay it, some fucking hopeful from Okeecoke from Muskogee will fucking come and would pay $1,500 because they watch Sex and the City on HBO and they want to live that fucking fantasy.
They have the money for whatever reason.
Yeah, it's disgusting. It really is. But when I was growing up on Lower East Side, it was a fucking, talking about the rise of crack, the rise of AIDS.
Right.
You know, I mean, I've played in abandoned buildings. I mean, you know, up, up the area, like I said, Alphabet City. Alphabet City was fucking, you know, it was all burnt out. It was fucking, it looked like Beirut. You know, it looked like the end of the fucking world.
Have you been there now?
Now it's all rebuilt. And the funny thing is, the first time this episode, take a shot. You know, I still have cousins that live in that area.
Okay.
They've been there since, you know, like me. Like, my mother lived in the same apartment since 1972.
Yeah.
My cousins are still there, but the air has come up around them. So that's the funny thing, is to see all these hipsters move into a ghetto. You know what I'm saying? Or the ghetto people haven't left yet. And right. They want them out.
Right.
You know, but you see them try to be all, you know, you see the corny white guy with his white sneakers riding his 10-speed bike.
Right, the bike.
You know, he's going to save the world, but he wants to live in Manhattan.
Okay.
You know, and he's...
Now, so would you say it's still ghetto?
The Alphabet City?
Yeah.
See,
I went there, like,
Avenue D is still fucked up because that's the project.
Okay. Because I've been there for whatever reason. I don't know what the hell. I think for my job, I had to go down there. What the hell is this?
Avenue D
I mean,
is still the project.
I thought that was Alphabet City, I thought.
Yeah, the closer you get to Avenue A. Avenue A is gentrified as fuck.
Mm-hmm.
But Avenue has always been a main thoroughfare. The closer you go to Avenue B, C, and D. When you get to D, that's it. You're done. That's the project. Then the next thing over is the East River.
Yeah.
And that's where all my cousins live, in Avenue D.
In the river.
And we called that the Ave. Even though it's technically Alphabet City, it was just called the Ave. I lived in my part of the neighborhood was called the Hill. And
the Hill.
Because there's hilly parts in it. And the
Hill
and the Ave have a notorious long standing beef with each other.
So
you know what I'm saying?
Cousins fought, or?
No, that's the whole thing. It's like, when I went to go visit my cousins, I felt like I was in enemy territory.
Yeah.
Like,
you don't wear colors.
Don't let people know you're from the Hill. Don't let, you know. And, so.
That's funny. Cause they're not far from each other.
Yeah, then, no, you can, no, but it was just.
Just something.
Nothing ever really happened. I mean, you know, if you went there popping shit, you're gonna get your ass kicked. Yeah, Hill, motherfucker!
I'm from the Hill, yo! Where's Maggie Gyllenhaal?
She's probably from the Ave.
She's easily from the Ave. Your cousin's home.
But A, like I said, A, B, and C, well, A and B are definitely gentrified. You know, you still have a couple holdouts that have been there for the past 30 years, but C and D, you know, it's still,
they're holding it down.
Yeah, they're still keeping it real because it's the projects, and I guarantee you someday they're going to rip down the fucking projects. Or, you know, my best friend in high school, his name was Eric. His mother used to live in this place in Brighton Beach that was, it used to be projects. Donald Trump bought it, fixed it up.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still the projects.
These
are Donald Trump projects.
No, it's just, Trump
like,
projects.
I mean, you know, they fix it up, like the lobbies are real nice, but like, since growing up in Lower East, all my friends live in the projects.
Yeah.
They have this cookie cutter shape to them, you know what I'm saying? And so the apartments are shaped like project apartments. It's just, now they have track lighting, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, just like cleaner inside.
Yeah, and you know, they souped up the lobby. The lobbies are gorgeous, but you can't change the shape of the apartment.
Right.
It's still that institutional, feel to it.
Trump projects. Thanks, Trump. Always helping out.
And those people were paying a lot of fucking money to live there. And you're living in the projects.
Anyway, isn't that ridiculous?
And, yeah, it's just...
Project money.
It just...
And it's not worth it. Like, it's not worth that amount.
Yeah, it's... Now that I'm not really in New York City anymore, it's like...
You're basically paying to live in
New York. Yeah. Like, once my mother passes, I have no fucking... I mean, of course, my dad, but, you know... But
yeah,
my dad, it's a different story. Like, my dad, when I go visit, it's to visit. Like, I'll stay in my mom's house.
Mm.
You know, and once my mom passes, and my mom ain't going nowhere. She retired. She's not like, a lot of people go down to Florida, you know, being Puerto Rican, a lot of people go to Puerto Rico and
right.
stuff like that. My mom goes, you're burying me in this house. Like, yeah, I ain't going anywhere. So, you know, so once she passes, I'll have no reason to go to Manhattan anymore. You know what I'm saying?
See, Maggie Gyllenhaal. You're going to the Avenue.
Well, I mean, I want my daughter to know her culture, but other than that, you know.
That's it. You're done. Cutting off all
ties. Because I go there now and it's like there's nowhere to park and there's fucking traffic. I've gotten spoiled by Rochester and dealing
where
with
there's
like,
actually spots to park.
Where there's. I mean, there's traffic here, but nothing like New York City. You know what I'm saying?
People get good about driving here, and I'm like, I've seen it where people are just stopped.
Yeah, you can.
They're not moving for an hour.
I mean, except for when there's traffic, you can get from any part of Rochester to any other part of Rochester in 45 minutes at the worst,
easily,
at the absolute worst. And I kind
Stop
of gotten spoiled for that. You know, I mean, you know, but then I feel like I would like Raven to kind of
Spread
know the hardships of New York City. But then again, I'm an asshole, so maybe I shouldn't raise it the way I was raised.
Uh-oh.
You know, shit, I was... You know, I was...
Oh,
10 years old taking the subway. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, by myself.
How much did the subway
cost them? I remember when the subway was 85 cents. Now it's like...
$2.25.
Yeah. So, you know, I remember my dad giving me money. Like, give me money, and then, like, I would have the change to buy candy.
I don't know if maybe they made it now or what, but, like, for kids living in the city to go... That take the subway to school.
Uh-huh.
Like, there's some pass that you get.
Well, we used to have when I went to high school. It was a train pass where back in my day, you actually had to show it to the person so they can buzz you in because there was turnstiles and then there was an actual door.
Yeah,
so
they buzz you to the door.
And the fucking place right by me, there was always this. And this has nothing to do, I'm not trying to make any kind of political or social or racial. It was a Muslim woman.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? She had the head wrap, the head thing on. And she was just miserable. You could just look at her and tell she was miserable with her life and her job or whatever. And I'm just trying to like get her attention. Like I'm holding my pass here. You know, and she just would just like stare at me. Like, you know, hello. And, you know, I would just, and she was just, and then she would buzz me in. Like, she would just stare at me for like a second. I'm like, come on, you know, I'm not goofing off. I don't look like a hoodlum. I don't.
No, could you only use it during like school time?
You can only use it during school hours, but.
There's time to get away with it.
Because I think you could, if I remember correctly, I think you could use it up to like 6 or 7 or something. So you would go somewhere after school.
Well, that's cool,
and then,
though.
But if you went, but even, I guess you're technically, if you were going somewhere after school, like you went to the museum after school and then you got back, you know, in my opinion, that should be paid for. But now what they did is the kids actually have, their school ID is actually the thing you swipe now. Cause now they have the MetroCard.
Yeah.
And you can swipe your MetroCard. And that's a whole fucking scam because you put your money on the card.
Do you think they would scam the children?
But I'm saying MetroCards in general.
Oh, yeah.
It's like when you go to,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, no. Well, you know, like they want you to, you know, like right now it's $2.25. You put $20 on the card. Somewhere around, you know, I don't know the math, you're gonna end up with 75 cents on that card or something.
There was one, I forget. Maybe it was like it was like where you get like 3 or 4 rides for so much.
Uh-huh.
But it doesn't add up to $2.25 each and you're left always with 10 cents. Always on the card 10 cents.
And then what are you gonna do? Walk around with 30 cards with 10 cents and then
that's to cash these in.
And you never get money. It's not like
4 rides for something. Always 10 cents.
Yeah, you're never. There's no such thing as taking that card to the booth.
Yeah.
Like let's say you had $20 on the card and it was your poor week in between paydays. It's not like okay, sure, we'll swipe it. Well, here's $20 back.
No,
they'll look at you and tell
you
to take a hike.
Because I'm supposed to be paying $2.25. So when I would go to work sometimes, I pay it every now and then. You know how I would always go, you know, in the morning, it's a big rush. And you know how, like, the people exiting and go through the door? Just go right in.
Well, see,
all the time.
I
don't know how I never got caught. It was blatantly in front of the booth.
Because you're white.
But, yeah. But I didn't have it. Everybody's coming at me, just head down and go. I'm like, this is bullshit. I'm not sitting here paying this much.
Because if you're wearing baggy jeans and had hair and cornrows, fuck it, you
guys. Yeah, I had, like, the business suit on. I'm doing something with
And you're lucky because there are, I mean,
people get arrested for that shit.
That's what I'm saying. They're, transit cops have undercover, you know what I'm saying? You know,
to this day, I don't know why I got baldy, because I'm scared of getting caught like this, because that's so stupid of a reason to get arrested for.
Yeah,
but man, like,
don't give me any grief about shit falling off a truck.
I know. Like, it's such a stupid, like, if I do get caught, I'd be like, this is stupid.
Yeah.
Like, what an idiot.
And you'd have been, you know, the cops, and they make you fucking stand there, because that happened to my friend. Now, mind you, my friend who is a cop now, hopped the turnstile. First,
That's way too obvious.
He hopped the turnstile, got onto the train,
because
the way to do it was, you would stand up by the stairs and wait till you hear the train come. It would have to be one of those stations where, as soon as you get down to the bottom of the stairs, the train is, like, right there.
Yeah, okay.
Not those other ones you have to go down 2 or 3 flights of stairs. But it was, so you would wait,
like,
you would wait to hear the train coming, you would hop the turnstile, then jump on the train.
Hopefully. That's how I went through the door. There's so many people. I'm like, I'm lost in the crowd.
And hopefully the person didn't, the person at the booth didn't shout out because then the motorman would stop the train. But, so, my buddy who's a cop now, hopped the turnstile, got on the subway,
And then when he got onto somebody, he cracked open a 40, and the undercover cops are there. So he actually got a desk appearance ticket, but that shows you that, that they forgave him because he had that on his history, but he's a cop now.
Right.
Like, who better? And he used to do graffiti and all this shit, and I'm like.
It's always those people that become cops.
Yeah, who better to catch criminals than a guy who was a semi-criminal?
Is he working in, like, the subway? That would be a perfect job for him.
Yeah, it was, you know.
Put him down there, he knows what kids do. See, I feel like I would try and do the turnstile thing, but I mess up, I'm clumsy. Mm-hmm. Like, my foot gets stuck, crack my head open, trying to run to the train. Maybe, like, just
face
follow
all
the blood trail, you'll get her. Like, and then I'd be like, alright, I got the 225 on me, if you guys
nah,
want.
Nah, like that, you're going down, you're going to the tombs, you're going like, central booking.
My cracked head. Like, yeah, I'd mess it up somehow.
And,
there was my criminal, just going through that door. A few times a week.
Well, I think.
I'm pretty sure my picture's probably up in that. It was the Upper East Side, too.
Yeah.
So maybe that's why they live
Yeah. On. Like I said, they're a little more vigilant in in the bad neighborhoods.
Oh, she's going to work.
And, well, like, what was I gonna say? Like that woman that used to give me trouble going through to buzz me in.
Yeah.
I think she was hesitant because kids would, cause what happened was once you open that door, it's up to you to close it.
Mm-hmm.
Cause those things weren't necessarily spring loaded cause you got women coming out with their baby carriages, some people with like delivery type stuff. If you don't lock it all the way, and what's the person in the booth gonna do? They're in a booth with a lot of money on them. They can't go out and
they're not letting me stroll around.
Yeah, so I think, you know, I think not me, but I think the kids in my neighborhood, you would go through the door
and not close it.
So, like, I guess that's why she was, like, giving me
the... blaming her for being mad at you when it's your friends.
It's not, yeah. I was just trying to get this... And, you know...
Her and Jake going through.
Now, mind you, you know, I lived in Manhattan. I went to school in fucking Brooklyn. I had a long-ass commute in front of me.
I was like, oh, like, one time I was in the Lower East Side because I worked, unfortunately, on Wall Street for a little bit. I did sales, so I wasn't, like, doing anything with the banks. But, so I was on the Lower East Side there, the middle, whatever you want to call it. And a friend of mine lives in Brooklyn, so I went to visit her after work one day. So I'm like, oh, it's just Brooklyn. Like, oh,
it's right
the bridge,
there.
It's right there.
I can see it from here.
Yeah, you can see it, but I was on the thing for like 45 minutes. I'm like, seriously?
Yeah. And
it's a long ways.
And like, if you were driving, now let's just say there was absolutely no traffic, which is unless you're driving in the middle of the night. If you were driving my house from where I used to live to my school in Brooklyn, I went to Brooklyn Technical High School.
Yeah.
Driving, you'd probably be there in like 20 minutes, 25 minutes.
The subway,
you know, an hour and
isn't
15 minutes. Yeah.
It's just so crazy to me.
And it was such a
It's convenient. Like, subway, I consider it convenient because you're just basically in it, but how long it takes.
Yeah.
Like,
it was.
Come on.
Because when I went to school, I was there like when it went from $1 to $1.25. Mm-hmm. But like I said, we had the pass. But after I left school, then they gave, your school ID was actually a Metro card was your school ID. Because that's how they do the employees who work for the MTA, the Metropolitan Transit Authority.
Now, did you, to get the card, are you, your parents or whatever paying like how much does it cost for the card? Or do they get like a bill?
No, the city pays for it.
The same way your pass got you through the door. Okay.
It's the same, you know, because the city was technically paying your bill then.
Okay.
It's the same deal.
Like you in the beginning had to pay like so much for.
Oh no! Thank goodness. Well, I mean, you know, some people, you know, like where I grew up, people were fucking broke. You know,
right.
I mean, they don't have fucking a pot to piss in. You know what I'm saying? I grew up with fucking friends that are, but see, most of my friends that were really broke went to school locally.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? They didn't get into a specialized high school.
Right.
You know, I'm going to fucking I'm a lot good it fucking did me, but you know,
I agree. Those private schools, I know people went to private schools around here, they didn't do shit.
Yeah.
That's what waste your parents' money. I mean,
it's, you know, and
I don't get the whole hype.
Yeah. So,
maybe because I went to a public school.
Yeah, I didn't know. And I took those trains, you know, and there was a time, let me tell you, you could drop me off anywhere in the five boroughs, I'll get my ass home.
Right.
All you have to do is let me know where a subway is.
Well, yeah, once I got used to everything, that's it. Like, I was the same way, like, oh, give me a freaking subway, and boom, I know how to get from here to there.
Because, and actually,
it's easy once you figure it all
this
out.
Is the story I was going to say the other episode when I was interrupted. By Jackie. Because one of the main subways in Manhattan, one of the main stations is West 4th Street.
Okay, yeah.
Now, it may have changed, but the last time I was there, it was the A, B, C, D, E, F, and Q lines.
That's, yep.
And so, Jesus Christ.
That could take you anywhere.
Exactly,
you
anywhere.
On anyone,
so, as long as like I saw the A, B, C, D, E, F, and Q, and then the only ones that weren't there are like all the number trains, the right. IRT trains. So I would just say, you know, if I was on the 6th line, where does this transfer? But then again, if it was the 6, oh, the 6 goes on to Beekman, which transfers to the F. And so,
the maps are real idiot-proof, and I like that. Like the subway maps.
Yeah, well, shit, all those.
People get so confused. I'm really, it's right
there. Well, I mean.
I like
the, when you have large groups of people, they get stupider.
Right.
And so, and there's so many people in New York City that you have to make it as idiot proof as possible.
Relax, we can get through this.
So, West 4th Street, now, when you go upstairs in West 4th Street, it is 6th Avenue and 4th Street, which is 6th Avenue, Avenue of the Americas.
Right.
Super main thoroughfare.
I was gonna say, that's a huge.
For anybody that's a fan of basketball. West 4th Street is, I forgot the name of the park, but it's a super duper famous basketball park. Like,
really?
Yeah, like,
look it up.
Like, there's a whole culture of like underground basketball, like, you know, like, and of course, like, you know, a lot of NBA players have been there also. Go there on a Sunday? Holy shit. And it's not like I could walk into the park and play basketball. These people have an organized event, even though there's no official. Yeah, because I know the one in Harlem is Rucker Park, which is, that's world famous. But there's another one down on West 4th Street and 6th Avenue. And, like, it's just a bullshit city park. But, I mean, it's, there's people who take care of it, and it's like, you know, for, like, the underground. Like, I know the big one that everyone knows, well, not everyone knows, but it's called And One. Like, you see the brand name or whatever. Well, they have, like, organized events there and stuff like that. And, like I said, it's a city-run park. But it's notorious for having, and you know, you'll go, and you could go there totally for free, if you don't mind the crowd, and watch these guys play basketball. It's mind-blowing. And I'm not a sports fan. But across
the cage.
The cage, yes. That's, I mean, that's what they call it. Yeah, the cage. That's the nickname. I could have sworn I had another name. Well, right across the street from there. Now, I used to hang out in that area. I used to hang out for street ball, I guess. Yeah, not even basketball, street ball. You know, a lot of trash talking, a lot of, you know, guys with incredible talent.
Yeah.
So I used to hang out in that area in East Village in Washington Square Park. And have you ever seen? Yeah, the West 4th was A, B, C, D, E, F, and Q. And anybody who's a fan of the show Louie, he gets out of the West 4th Street station and he walks over to the Comedy Cellar. I mean, there's a place called, there's the Cage, the Blue Note if you like jazz. Anybody goes to NYU, there's a whole NYU campus is there.
Bleecker Bobs.
It took me a second to think of the name. Before CDs and before MP3s or whatever, and I believe it's still there. It's still, Bleecker Bobs was the one place you can get, like, any fucking underground album.
Oh, cool.
You know, like, I bought,
it's still open now.
I believe it's still there. And cool. It's one of the holdouts because
that's pretty cool to survive through
all this. Because there was Tower Records. That wasn't next to West 4th, but I guess you can technically walk there. Yeah, because actually Tower Records was on 4th Street, but you'd be walking about 4 or 5 avenues, you know, which is like 10 blocks. But yeah, Tower Records.
That was huge.
It was tall. It was a couple stories high. And. Tower in general. And, was there ever a tower up here in Rochester?
I don't think so.
Okay, I think, cause I know they had, there's definitely one big famous one in California. There was one in the city. And that was one of the crazy places where you would go, but it didn't survive. But like, I went there one day and Jonathan Davis, the singer of Korn, is in there. Now mind you, he's with security.
Right.
And it's like, I swear to God, now what happens is, he's with security, I'm standing at the aisle, I'm looking at a CD, and I see like activity out of the out of the peripheral vision. I look up, it's fucking Jonathan Davis. I'm like, and you have to understand, I love Korn. You know what I'm saying? And,
do you feel like a freak on a leash?
I've seen Korn live seven times easily. So of course, standing right behind him, two very large,
he's not there by himself.
Surly guys you don't want to fuck with. But I said, I said, hey John, I'm a big fan, love your music. And he was like, thank you, that's cool, I appreciate it. I forgot exactly, but he was real humble and quiet. And, he was buying, Cannibal Corpse, which is, that's like real, real hardcore music. He was buying they had a box set called 15 Year Killing Spree. He was buying the box set, so I actually met, I guess if you want to say, I met Jonathan Davis at Tower Records.
Jonathan Davis.
waiting. And I remember going there.
Friend Jonathan Davis.
Yeah, that's what I loved about living in New York City, running to celebrities. I remember going to Tower Records. It's kind of like my story when I went to go see, when I went to that bachelor party and it was like Bon Jovi and Chris Rock. I went to Tower Records. It was the midnight release of one of the Metallica albums. I don't know. It must have been Load or Reload.
Midnight releases of CDs.
Yeah. And go wait in line. Now that night.
There was no shootings there.
That night, it was Metallica and Erykah Badu. So okay, once again, the line was so, such a
diverse,
eclectic group of people. And once again, we were, no hostility. Right. No, it was so, but it's
everybody's
so funny because two fucking, in my opinion, opposite
genre,
sides
yeah.
of the spectrum. Absolutely. Because, you know, Erykah Badu is soul and smooth and,
right.
and you know, Metallica. So,
what's Metallica like?
And, you know, the Blue Balls music. It's, you know, bang your head against the wall because your girl rejected you. Now you got to shoot up a theater music.
Oh, that's what I was going to say. When your friend James, not our friend. Jonathan Davis is our friend. Like, the Joker.
And, but one thing about Tower Records is, you did not fuck with their security. They, I've
did
seen,
you do it once?
No, not me. I've seen security on
just like
a couple
doors.
Of different, they, like, though, they were so organized in their thuggishness, you would get four security guards carrying you out by your arms and legs. Like, so
like
the person is, the person is stomach down.
Yeah.
You have a security guard on one arm, you know, one for each leg,
yeah.
where your stomach is on the ground.
Yeah.
I've seen, well, that's how they drag you back into the building. If you try to run out, they'll tackle you. Well, what happened was, one guy will tackle you, hold you down until the other three come, and they all grab your leg and drag them into Tower Records. Now, I worked in that area as an auxiliary police officer. I told you I worked in the 9th precinct. And so that was on Broadway. Broadway was the very end of our jurisdiction. But it was on our side of Broadway.
Like, in view, like,
yeah, and you know, and so,
shot away.
Well, because I've been into their back room whenever they had shoplifters and they would take a picture and there was a fucking wall. Now, this is the East Village, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, especially you would see more, it was like punk rockers and stuff, because
right.
that was right off, that was not too far from St. Mark's Place, which is like notoriously a punk rock center. You know, so people stole music from there all the time. So to see the security guards tackle the shit out of it. I mean, I've seen
that once. Like, I'd be like, tell me, like, don't fuck with Tower.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying is that, like, I never really shoplifted, but, after, well, no, I had an ex-girlfriend who shoplifted and she was back when, they still had Nobody Beats the Wiz. I don't know if you, that was a store in New York City.
No.
It was called, the store, everyone called it the Wiz, but their official name was Nobody Beats the Wiz. And she used to steal CDs from there all the time. Cause she used to just basically just blatantly crack. Cause remember CDs used to have that big long case on it? She used to crack it. And what I loved about her, she used to steal two copies of each CD so she could have a copy and I could have a copy. It's so sweet.
Because that is love right
and
there.
And that was in Union Square back when Nobody Beats the Wiz was in Union Square. And I was going to get this summer night school. Summer school, but at night. It was so fucking awesome. So you could work during the day. You could still have a summer job and go to school. Hey, you're earning money during the day and then doing the bullshit classes at night just to get through with it. So she used to go to Nobody Beats the Wiz, steal CDs. I would meet her at this, cause this is, even I went to Brooklyn Tech, it was called Washington Irving High School where I went to summer night school. And she would, mind you, and I never told her, please get me this CD, please get me that CD.
But she knew what Chris wanted.
She knew, well, I mean, she stole what she liked. So I would appreciate, like the Weezer Blue album, like the one with, if you want to destroy my sweater, cause there's like, four or five different albums called The Weezer. The album's called Weezer, but there's four of them. One of them's the blue one, the green one, I think there's a red one.
Color-coded.
So she stole me the blue Weezer album. And stuff like that. You know, she got me Metallica.
Okay.
But that's the whole thing is, it's hard to shop for a guy like me, or hard to steal
for
a guy like
me,
because I had everything I wanted.
Right.
You know, I pretty much, anything else I didn't really want to hear. You know, she stole me Bad Religion CDs, and she was a big fan of Bad Religion. Coincidentally, we went to a show. No, she's doing just fine. You know, my internet stalking. she's doing just fine now. Yeah,
fine.
Because the last time we saw each other wasn't that good and.
What did you see at Tower Records? Like, did you see somebody running out stealing?
I've seen a couple of times. And even when I was,
even when I was an auxiliary cop, now we weren't supposed to answer jobs, but we used to go, right. We used to go and answer jobs. You know, we go and just stroll by and see what's going on. And like I said, I've seen them personally while I've been in the store, and I even seen them even when I'm, and they don't give a fuck that there's, even I was there with other real police officers. Yeah. They were like kind of like covered by tower. Like, go ahead and tackle these motherfuckers.
Yeah, like it's not.
You know, and like I said, they were organized to the point where the security guards would.
What kind of training they went on?
It was all big fucking gym, gym rats, big, you know, muscular guys. Like, well, I obviously anybody who stole from there must have not known
right.
what
what
they were like, because Tower Records was no joke. And like I said, we responded to a shoplifting thing, and then, you know, we let you in the back room, and, you know, and it was cool, and, but, you know, it's always shitty and fucked up in the back room, but, like, you know, they used to take, all these places do, they take a photo of the shoplifter, put on the, you know, the wall of shame or whatever, just to, you know, keep an eye out for them. And, you know, like, shit, that's how old I am, and, you know, buying CDs, you know, I guess back what I was saying, like, Bleecker Bobs,
yeah.
Like, Bleecker Bobs is still there. And what I liked about them is that, like, if they didn't have what you were looking for, they could order it for you. Like,
cool.
You know, and once again, this is way before the internet, you know what I'm saying? And so, you know, I would go there and, like, and then they actually sold, like, bootlegs and stuff like that, which I guess, you know, they're skirting the law. Because now Metallica, re-released, Metallica has a legitimate release called Garage Inc. Now Garage Inc. is two CDs. One is a re-release of an old album, and then the second one is, like, all new. It's all cover songs.
Okay.
So the first album is an album they put out a long time ago called Garage Days.
Okay.
And then the second CD, just to make it, you know, fair for the fans, like, okay, let's do a whole new other album of cover songs. So the first CD, the older stuff, there was an album called Garage Days, or Garage Days Revisited. And the funny thing is, take a shot.
Got it.
The album was called The 595 Garage Days. And they even, like, it even says on the cover, do not pay any more than that, or whatever. You know, because it was right when, after the first bassist, Cliff Burton, died in a bus accident.
Yeah.
They had the new bassist, Jason Newsted. So kind of like to break them in, they put out this album covering other people's music to, like, running through the chops and stuff like that.
Amazing.
And then again, and the funny thing is, actually, when you really listen to the mix, there's no bass in the mix anyway. Yeah, they really hazed his ass.
Poor guy.
So, you know, that was a very rare record. Mm-hmm. And in time came a collector's item. So what Metallica did was, that's why they released Garage Days, because they know people were going crazy paying big fucking amounts of money for the original album.
Right.
I paid $100.
Really?
For the album.
You're sick.
Yeah. Which I think I left in my house in
why
Jersey.
Didn't
I don't
steal it.
No, you know, that place, it was up on the wall in the back of Bleecker Bob's. And plus it was an album. She used to steal CDs.
Yeah.
This is an album. I paid $100 for that album. And that's why Metallica now, like, you could go online right now, even on, legitimately on YouTube, they have concerts released because all these people were making money off Metallica, selling bootleg concerts and stuff like that. So, like, fuck, here's a professional recorded show, you know what I'm saying? Cause, you know, there's so, like, Metallica has so much money right now, it's not like they're losing anything. So, that was that whole, I didn't even get to my story. And we're way over an hour, but I'll take care of that later. I just wanted, there was a Taco Bell there. It was on West 4th and 6th Avenue. When my friends and I used to hang out in Washington Square Park, right? It was across the street from the cage. And,
perfect.
Yeah. We used to hang out in Washington Square Park, and it wasn't indicative, but have you ever seen the movie Kids?
Yes. It's real fucked up.
Those kids' lives were very close to what me and my friends were like, and kind of hanging out in that area. Not that we would like them, because it was kids. It was Casper.
Was like, McLovin.
Yeah.
The main kid, and I was like, is that McLovin?
And that was, early Rosario Dawson.
Yeah.
Was in that movie. Chloe Sevigny is in that movie.
Oh no.
Chloe Sevigny. She's in Big Love now, but she was in a couple other movies, but.
Gorgeous.
I think she's good. I think she's.
The blonde from Big Love.
Yeah. She's gorgeous.
Whoa.
What are you talking? Oh, she's.
She looks
fine.
Man-ish. Chris, you love men.
Well,
rumors.
There's something I want to. I wanted to get out of here on the podcast. I think Chloe Sevigny is a sexy fucking woman. Holy smoke!
Attractive. She's gross. Good luck with that, Chris.
Okay.
But if she wants to make an appearance on our podcast,
I love shit. I'll just send me a fucking used napkin or something. I don't know. So that, I don't want to say it was close to, but I mean, that movie definitely caught the vibe of that, that time. And do you remember like when they break into the swimming pool and there's a guy like flopping his, that guy actually used to hang out in that park or whatever.
Really?
And there's even a scene in the beginning of Half Baked where, Dave Chappelle goes, yeah, you can buy weed from the dreadlocks at the Washington Square Park, but most of the, that's not even weed. Like, you know, there were a lot of, because Washington Square Park was basically that was where all the kids from NYU used to hang out. So all the dreads, all these dreadlock guys would go there and sell weed, but since there's all these goofy, corny white kids from the middle of America, they sold them fucking anything. Fucking, they would rip grass out of the ground, put in a dime bag, and fucking sell it to them. And sell them, was it, not, what's that spice that looks like marijuana?
Oregano.
Oregano, yeah. They would sell them bags of oregano.
Sell that pizza.
And,
that's hot.
That's not a good picture of her.
And she looks like that 90% of the time.
That's not a good picture of her. She is...
Whoop!
She is an attractive woman.
Yeah. And that's that.
There's a really... Anybody... She did a movie called The Brown Bunny, which is...
Oh, see, you're going off of one movie.
Well, no, well, that movie...
The Brown Bunny. That's also
Brown. Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's called The Brown Bunny. Or Brown Rabbit or something like that. Well, let's put it like this. She stars in a movie with her boyfriend. Certain acts are performed. Oh, wait, hold on. Oh, that's a bad picture. Okay, just, for everyone listening, Kristen is looking up pictures of Chloe Sevigny and holding it up and saying, I think Chloe Sevigny is a very attractive woman. And
a lot of bad photos, Christopher.
Oh, God. It's okay. We'll just agree to disagree. I think she's hot. And,
So if you start dating her, I'm going to be mad. And
understand, I generally don't like blonde hair, blue eyes, and I think, I don't know, I think she's attractive. I don't know, say she's mannish, and hey, then I guess I'm a man.
For some reason, she rubs me the wrong way. I don't know why, because I do, because I didn't like her character in Big Love, because she was a bitch.
Yeah, she does look genuinely does crazy, though. Part. She looks genuinely nuts.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that's, I for some reason, I just like crazy women. She looks off edge. She looks like
she
the
looks
kind
like
of guy...
She'll
take all your clothes and put it in the tub and burn them.
See ya. Burn the house.
Why are you looking at my girl? That's my fucking cousin. That's even worse.
Yeah. Like, she's like, who's the TLC one?
Left Eye. Lisa Left Eye Lopez. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. She was burning the guy's clothes in the bathtub. So we used to hang out and go to Taco Bell. Wow, this show's just going over. Well, fuck it. We haven't recorded in a while.
So. It's a 4-hour episode, folks.
So we went to Taco Bell.
I'm gonna show you every ugly photo.
You must be skipping a lot of photos.
No way.
I think she's a good looking woman. We used to hang out in Taco Bell all the time. We used to call it Taco Hell. We used to loiter there. We used to loiter there. Fucking hours on end. We'd all buy like one burrito and it'd be like 15 kids hanging out in there.
And 99-cent burrito.
So there was this big, and that's another thing you definitely look online. Someone came with like a camera and they were filming Taco Bell. Big, giant rats. I mean, big, huge. And you see the rats
like
jumping from table to the floor. Yeah, and it was one of the, cause that's all owned by like the Yummy Corporation or whatever. So it's like, it's KFC, Taco Bell, Dunkin' Donuts. Baskin Robbins, they're all owned by the Yummy Corporation.
Like the lights go out and everybody leaves those and you just see.
Yeah, you just see all the rats. And so, but then again.
It's my last one.
Okay, and she's pulling out another picture. I don't like her with the short hair. Yeah, so they actually shut it down. I forgot what it is now. I think it's like a Hallmark store or something. But it was, it was a food place over West 4th Street.
Yeah.
West 4th Street is one of the, well, probably, you know, maybe the third or fourth biggest train station in New York City, you're gonna have mice, and then the place that serves food, you're automatically
asking for
rats when you have a food, not to mention in New York City, over a fucking subway, but you see, there was a big thing, and people were just showing up with their cameras, just shooting video, and you just see these rats jumping from table to table,
jumping from the
garbage, and, you know, like,
seeing the video, like, on the news they had,
and and it's like, you know how many hours I spent in there, how many fucking burritos, how many burrito grandes, or whatever,
like,
burrito supremes, and the rats are just dancing. It's not unusual to be loved by anyone.
Spinning around. Yeah, what's the problem?
M-I-C-K-U-I-M-O-U-S-E.
Food's still good, man.
Yeah, fuck that.
Still good.
That fucking rat was tasty, goddammit.
Oh.
Seven herbs and spices.
That's the eight herbs and spices.
All right. Time to pay the bills.
Paying bills, baby.
Please visit www.doublejackpot.us where you can find links to everything involved with the show. We have links to our eBay page. Or you could just look up what I'm selling. My screen name or my handle is XLNYC, as in extra large New York City. I'm selling comic books, video games, heavy metal. I recently, just as of last night, I put a whole lot more other movies up. I have more like action movies and horror movies and stuff like that, a couple of comedies, just stuff I'm basically selling off my collection. All the money goes to support the show because this stuff ain't free and it ain't cheap. Yeah, I have a shelf over here with my DVDs, and it's gotten significantly smaller. There's certain stuff I'm just not going to sell. I'm not going to sell my Star Wars DVDs. I'm not going to sell my Kevin Smith. I'm not going to sell my Kevin Smith movies. And as much as I'm a huge David Fincher fan, I'm only keeping a few of his movies. I'm keeping like Fight Club, Seven, and The Game, and everything else I'm selling. You know, but I'm going to get around to selling like my Matrix, my Flash Gordon, Star Wars, Clone Wars, a couple things here and there. You could also find us on facebook.com/twostrangers1podcast.
Like us.
Hover over the like button and click the option show in newsfeed. If you enjoy this show, please share it with your friends. Get the word out. You can subscribe to us on iTunes, or if you have an Android device or Kindle Fire, you are available on the Stitcher app. Those are the only two ways you're definitely going to get every episode. What else? Facebook, iTunes, Stitcher, eBay. You can go to the website, www.doublejackpot.us, which is the central hub of all these links. You could also buy my book, Double Jackpot, $15 for a hard copy, $5 for a downloadable PDF, and every dollar goes to the show, because it's not free, it's not cheap.
Thank you. We
certainly hope you enjoyed listening to the show, as much fun as we had making it. Thank you for listening to Two Strangers, One Podcast. I'm Chris.
And I'm Kristen.
Don't be a stranger.
See ya.
Bye.
All right, here we go, man. Go ahead. You want to read
Double Jackpot.
What is it?
It is a self-published book by Christopher Colon.
Chris Colon? Smells good to me.
But
look at her. That broke that fucking cold little look here. He's like, hee.
But it is spelled C-O-L-O-N.
Him punny.
But... Double Jackpot is a book about a comic book artist, Eric, who is in a loveless relationship with a materialistic Lynette.
Are you sure I didn't write this? I sounds hauntingly familiar.
He starts cheating on his girlfriend with a more creatively supportive woman, Nadia.
Well, I gotta meet her. Where's the Nadia?
There's your summer girlfriend.
Summer Nadia. Is Nadia.
Nadia?
Yeah, I think Nadia spelled with an A.
All right.
Both Lynette and Nadia play the double jackpot, the largest payout in lotto history, much like the recent Powerball. Both girls play his birth date as the winning numbers. Eric is now stuck between two of the country's richest women. Who will he choose? It's not that simple. This is a clever fucking idea,
yeah,
man.
Is.
Look at her. Fucking, she's impressed.
I am.
She got some summer reading. Christopher Colon smells real lovely with an original idea. This is. I've never heard this before.
I haven't either. This is a self-published book, much in the indie spirit as Kev's Clerks.
Oh, you don't even need to name check me. It's just a good idea. You could stand on your own, man. You don't even have to be like, hey, remember Clerks? This is nothing like that. This is way more original than Clerks. This is a good idea, man. Why didn't I think of this?
I need something to read. This book is part of the Comic Books, Heavy Metal, Video Games Trilogy Book 2. Odd I See, A Tale from the Road, coming soon.
Right on, man. It's part of a trilogy. This is the first part.
Way to write, man.
He's seeking a literary agent. Motherfuckers, anybody out there? There ain't no literary agents listening to this show. I assure you, sure. Sure. I assure you, sure. But somebody know a literary agent? Hook a motherfucker up! Chris Colon come up with an original idea. I should tell Raskin, that's a good fucking idea, to be honest with you. That's a fucking rom-com right there. Megan, get Raskin on the phone. Isn't it possible to get Raskin on the phone? No?
Yeah.
I want to run it past him, man. I want to, and if it happens, I get a taste, Chris Colon. I get a whiff, if you will.
The book could also be ordered on www.fbcbook.com. LULU.com.
That's Lulu.com.
I understand that. I just want to spell it out.
Normally one says it, that spells it. Still, Lulu.com. What is that? Do you know what it is?
I don't know. All right. The book could also be ordered on www.lulu.com. Search for Double Jackpot Christopher Cologne. A paperback version of the book is $15 and a PDF file is only $5.
$5 yeah. is insanely inexpensive. 15 is not even that bad for a paperback version.
No.
This is a $1 million idea right here. Like a fucking movie about a dude who fucking is stuck between two chicks, both of who play his birthday and win the lottery. Come on!
I
can see that trailer. Chris Cologne is on to something. Nobody else can smell it but me.
I'll read it.
Thank you. I'm going to make that smelly joke.
I know. You're trying to get me to laugh again.
It worked once. Double Jackpot is a self-published book by Chris Cologne, man. It's the first book in his comic books, heavy metal, video games trilogy. Book 2, Odd I See, A Tale from the Road, should be coming out soon. Get all the information at Chris Cologne, like a motherfucker, and his
totally
book,
read this.
Double Jackpot. I'm serious. I'm going to recommend that to fucking Raskin. How is that not a movie? You know what I'm saying? This could be a sexy movie. You could do an R-rated version. There could be nudity in it, and you could sell them fucking both chicks. Maybe a little penetration. Maybe a butthole shot. No butthole, no care.
I would like to formally apologize to Christopher Cologne. Right
no,
now,
sex sells. Chris Cologne will appreciate that. He's like, thanks for throwing a few buttholes in there, man.
Don't forget to check out twostrangersonepodcast.net, your one-stop resource for everything show-related. You can find links to subscribe to us on iTunes or on Stitcher. You could also find links to buy my book, Double Jackpot, on twostrangersonepodcast.net.
Fuck you, you're cool, and fuck you, I'm out.